Hello, welcome to Lookout with me, Andrew Kay. I think I've got the campest sofa I've ever had in my life today. I'm joined here by the truly extraordinary Nikki Mitchell.
Hello.
Barry Glennon, Sean Hutchinson, and the fabulous Dave Pop. Oh. It's lovely having you all here. I feel like I'm at home, really, even though we're in the studio with a green screen working for us. But it does feel like one of my normal parties, so it's lovely. I've known some of you a long time. I've known Nikki now for 32 years, which it's a lifetime, isn't it?
Back in Newport Street.
Back in Newport Street days, yes. And actually, funnily enough, I think on those first occasions we were sat on our dear friend Marion's very strange sofa with you holding a guitar playing for me.
So and here we are.
Things come round and round and round, don't they? Barry, I've only met this morning, but I have been watching little clips of Barry on VTubes. yes, not those clips.
Very little clips.
I saw them, but I thought, I won't watch those because it's unfair, isn't it? It would be embarrassing. I wouldn't want it to be read on the sofa. Sean, I've known you for some time now.
Yeah,
and of course,
met
Dave,
a couple of times.
Well, I've known you now for a few years, haven't I?
Well, we've been knocking around Brighton for a while.
Yes,
doing a bit of arty things.
Arty stuff, yes. Well, of course, I mean, you became very well known when you were the creative director over at Chocky Wocky Doodah, sadly no longer with us.
Yes,
and making those extraordinary cakes. Do you miss them?
I missed going in and talking to people every day.
Yeah.
We had a great gang of people working there. So it's very different being in a studio on my own, with just the dogs to talk to. They're not quite as responsive. But they don't mind cuddling them so much. So.
That's true. Yeah. I mean, it is very odd because I think all of us, we work in isolation a lot of the time, don't we? As creative people, you are basically at home writing. You, of course, write together.
Yeah.
But you actually work in isolation when you're doing that. Nikki, unless you're performing, you're working in isolation, aren't you?
Absolutely.
And I think, you know, my background in design and illustration is the same as yours. And a lot of those people work in studios on their own for long, long periods. So you must be a massive change for you now, because you're now working solely as an artist.
Yes.
No more cake.
So the cake career is over, and it was sort of becoming an artist, something that I was sort of doing anyway. But when Chocky closed, it sort of pushed me into the deep end and said, you know, so you want to be an artist? So you haven't got a job. So we've done you a favour. The company has closed down.
It was very sudden, wasn't it?
It was, So we just went into work one day and they said, you've got 15 minutes to pack your stuff.
Oh, my goodness.
Get out. I mean, we knew things weren't things were a bit rocky, but you can never be prepared to actually walk out and think, wow, I don't have a job anymore.
Scary.
So next Friday, I don't get paid. So, yes, now I'm trying to ply my wares as an artist. I've got an exhibition coming up in the Theatre Royal over
Christmas.
Now, this
is the second year you've done this. So you did one last year
with
Rocky Horror Picture Show. Rocky Horror Show, not Picture Show. That's the film version.
Not this one.
And
That went so well. They've asked
to
come
back
again. And this year they're doing Priscilla for their Christmas show. But I'm not doing a sort of a Priscilla-themed exhibition. I'm doing a sort of queer cabaret and burlesque performers from around the Brighton scene.
Brilliant.
So here's one of the pieces.
Let's have a look. It's going to flash a little on your screens. Because
Dave the Bear. He doesn't look quite like that. because he's got a green screen, but that still looks absolutely gorgeous, so I'm happy with that.
And I promise you, I only had to pose for about 10 minutes. It's extraordinary, really. And how kind of you to make my hair dark again after all these years of being a silver fox. I do love it. I love those bunny rabbits, don't you?
Yes.
So there's him and four other performers.
Who else have you done, then?
I've done... Dolly Rocket, who
Let's
does
lift it up so we can have a look.
Cabaret.
Oh, the wonderful Dolly. Isn't she fabulous?
She is.
David Hoyle, who isn't from Brighton, no, but he plays a few.
He plays here quite
a lot,
doesn't he?
I've seen him plenty of times.
Yeah.
So for each artist, I've done a slightly different style to show what they're like. So
these are actually paintings,
these
which
are paintings,
is slightly different from your other style.
Yeah, but in what will be shown in the foyer is all the prints, because they're...
Right.
In the foyer, they're like... five empty frames on the wall. Mm-hmm. So I've got to do five things that fit the same, fit the size. So each one I've done in a slightly different way to... So that's a very messy, anarchic one of David Hoyle. Yep. Whereas for Boogaloo Stew, he wanted something quite 60s psychedelic.
It's great, isn't
and
it?
And that's very neat. So that was just like an ink drawing that I scan into the computer and then I can colour it in there. And then you get those really nice, bright, flat colours.
Yeah. So, who's this one, Dave?
Well, this one's Stephanie Starlett.
Oh, wonderful Stephanie.
Because I think she's always seen herself as a sci-fi Barbarella kind of character. Strutting around with a sci-fi gun.
You should point out that these heels are no exaggeration.
Oh, no.
I mean, Stephanie does actually wear heels that big.
That's impressive.
It's, dangerous.
I think the waist might be a slight exaggeration, though.
Well, these days, Stephanie has been around a little time, hasn't she?
I forgive her.
And, of course, here we've got Boogaloo.
Boogaloo Stew and his 60s psychedelia.
I love that. That reminds me of the cover of my my school rough book, my Jotter.
Oh.
When in the 60s, when you would doodle on them, and we all doodled this lettering style. It was something that we could all do freehand. And we all had felt pens. In the days when felt pens used to leak and stain your fingers.
Yes.
Terrible colours. They're fantastic. I love the fact they're all in different styles. Nikki, so Dave's going to do your portrait, perhaps. Who would you like to be done?
Gluck.
Yeah?
Yes, Gluck. Do you know the famous portrait of Gluck?
Absolutely.
I think it was used on the cover of The Well of Loneliness. Yes, tweed suit.
Oh, yeah.
Monocle.
Yeah.
Paul Steven.
So you'd gluck yourself as well?
I'd gluck myself.
Go gluck yourself.
I've seen her out on the town and she's looked like she's been pretty well glucked. Yeah. Barry, who would you?
I'm apparently an Art Deco. What am I? Art Deco.
Oh, Russian
poster boy.
Poster boy.
Wow.
With a muff.
Well, I think you should have a muff.
Okay.
Definitely with a mask.
Yeah.
If you can stand it, dear.
And Sean, I'm only seeing you as a Pre-Raphaelite painter.
I quite like that. Yeah. I do. I like that.
I can see you arms outstretched, surrounded by flowers in a pond.
Oh, in a pond. Absolutely.
Ophelia. Ophelia. Let me have Ophelia.
And I want to be a Klimt, only because I like saying the word Klimt, but I quite like all that gold and sparkly stuff. I think that would suit.
Okay. Well, I'll crack on with those as soon as I get home.
Okay.
Yeah. It's my job sorted.
If you were to do one of yourself, how would you do it?
I think it'd have to be Michelangelo's David, wouldn't I?
Absolutely.
Oh,
yeah. It's the name.
Would you adjust certain of the attributes? Because he is notoriously
can have one of your
limited in the lower regions, isn't he, the original?
I think maybe I just have a well-placed fig leaf.
Oh, a fig leaf.
Yeah. That'll cover my modesty.
I love the idea that in the V&A, they have drawers full of genitals. That they're not. This is true. The Victorians were so prudish about some of those statues that they went round and tapped them off with a hammer, but they kept them all in
the drawers.
It may not be true, but I like the idea.
It's a good story.
Full of genitals. That'd be quite nice, wouldn't it?
It's a bit Jeffrey Dahmer.
I think some of my friends do have the equivalent of a drawer full of genitals by the bed. Let's not go there with that story. So, I mean, these are going to be available, they're prints of these images.
Yes, they'll be available from the theatre foyer or...
On your website.
On my website.
I noticed you've got a new website.
I have. So, www.davepopart.com. Or you can find me on Instagram or Facebook. and very easy to find. Yeah, and there's plenty of things there, so you can buy them as prints, or you can buy original sketches, or have your own portrait done. Why not commission that?
I'm tempted. I do already have a Dave Pop on my sitting room wall, and I have a Dave Pop drawing in my bedroom.
Nice.
And they're both absolutely beautiful. I think one of the things I've always been drawn to about your work, I love your work, as you know.
Thank you very much.
But you're not expensive.
I'm not expensive.
He said avoid using cheap. Well, you're not expensive, are you?
No, well, I think that was a lot to do with the fact I had a job. So selling my art was more like a hobby, and it was like, oh, this is nice.
Don't
if you sell a piece.
Hobby. Don't use the word hobby, it upsets me. We're going to go to a break now. When we come back, we'll be talking to Sean and Barry about the show that opens this week at the Purple Playhouse. We'll see you after these ads. Look out, we're here for you. Goodbye. Hello, welcome back to Lookout with me, Andrew Kay, in a giggling studio sofa this week. Barry, Sean, you're down in Brighton because you've got a show opening this evening.
We do, yes.
At the Purple Playhouse. What's it called?
It's called Barry and Sean, The Gift That Keeps On Giving.
A Christmas show.
It is.
A Christmas show.
Of sketch and song.
Song as well. You didn't say you were going to sing. I'd have had you singing on the show.
Oh, no.
We could do a little bit, couldn't we?
maybe in the next section we'll do that.
Sorry,
perhaps. You've been working together for some time now. That you've known each other a long time.
Long time. Long. We met in Central School of Speech and Drama
about 20 years ago.
20 years ago, yeah.
That's serious, proper grown-up acting stuff.
Proper grown-up acting stuff. Yeah, but we've abandoned that.
Yeah, no, we started working together about 5 years ago.
Yeah.
Before that, I was working as doing one-woman comedy shows, Edinburgh, London, and you were in music.
I was doing music. Writing, producing, arranging, singing. Just everything, really.
Oh, everything. Yeah,
so
everything.
Talented. A sofa full of talent.
Yeah, so
it's
talented.
Remarkable. It's remarkable. Tell us a little about this show, though.
Okay.
Well, we're loosely basing it around A Christmas Carol. So we've got
very
Scrooge
loosely,
and, you know, three spirits and then the little arch.
It's observational sketch comedy.
But there's a plot.
A very tenuous plot, but yeah.
Just enough to not be sued, isn't it?
Yeah.
Who's going to sue you? Charles Dickens?
Dickens' estate.
Dickens' estate, no. No, it's very loosely based. Some songs, there's some recurring characters we've been doing this.
What are our songs called?
Oh Holy Shite.
Yes.
Nice.
And what's the other one? It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas, but yeah, that's.
But
we've rearranged the words to be a swingers party.
Yeah, we're swingers, yes. As always, you know. So you've got a little bit of everything, really. So
character-based comedy, observational comedy.
Yeah.
And also just a lot of silly stuff as well.
Yeah.
Silly stuff Silliness. We like. I mean,
we've got a little bit.
Couldn't be more silly than this piece today on here, could it? we've got some VT, so let's have. I think we have a message from Australia.
Oh,
can
these
we,
are two of our characters, Todd and Gemma, and I think they're live at the moment.
They're live in Sydney.
From Australia.
Let's see. Let's calling Sydney. Come in, Sydney.
Oh, that's nice, isn't it?
So
I hope
sweet.
You guys are great up there. We're fantastic down under.
Oh, I hope your Yuletide is as gay as ours.
Oh, I'm absolutely sure it is.
Oh, that is so beautiful. So we want to say Merry Christmas
to the latest
TV viewers. And
Merry Christmas to all
that,
you at the latest.
Absolutely. We're going to pull a cracker, okay? Get a funny.
Okay, right. one, two, three.
Oh, this is...
You can never do live
no.
TV.
There we go.
Here's the joke.
Here's the joke. Okay. All right. What do you call a French nun with five boobs?
I don't know.
Sanctity.
I don't know. Maybe that's not it. Maybe this is a factual. This is factual.
Oh, that can be fun too.
Oh, facts are fun too. Well, with that, we just want to again, we wish you a Merry Christmas Merry up Christmas. There at the latest. Have a fantastic time and a Happy New Year.
All right, take care.
They're very nice. What a lovely couple. How sweet. It actually took me back 40 odd years to a year that I spent working with Barry Humphries.
Oh, really?
And I had a slight chill run through me the torturous year that I spent having a great time, but also being really put through the mill by the man because he's demanding.
Right.
He's demanding. They're great. And do they appear in the show as
they
well?
They do. They do. So they present a live TV show and they just... They're unaware of themselves, really.
Yeah. Oh, they're fantastic. So they're sort of like Holly Willoughby, really.
Well, very much so. Absolutely. Yes, absolutely. That's exactly what I thought. Yeah.
And you, of course, are the pairing of the silver fox.
Of course.
Naturally.
Of course, yeah.
But we have also, we've got a couple who absolutely hate each other, but they've obviously got something on each other. They seethe through... Various.
But they don't leave each other because if they did, they'd leak whatever information they have. So they're just chained to each other for life.
Horrid. Horrid. And we've got sort of the 1920s housewife.
Oh, the 19. Yes.
Jefferson, you ever so clever? And it's just like, yeah. So it's a little bit for everyone, really.
How long is it running for?
It's the
show's an hour, and we're doing
three nights.
Three nights.
Yeah.
Technically, we did one last night, didn't we?
Yeah, yeah. No, tonight.
Wednesday, yes. Thursday, Friday.
Wednesday, yeah. Thursday, Friday. Yes. So, if you're watching this, you've missed it tonight, but you can catch it tomorrow.
Can catch it. Yeah.
And on at 7:30. Yeah.
7:30 Purple Playhouse.
Exactly. And you'll be in bed early, so it's, you know, there's no excuse really, is there?
I do like a fringe length show, actually. I must confess, sometimes you go to the theatre and you're sitting there, you're looking at what I don't like is when you see a performer on stage doing that.
Oh my god,
and, I've never seen that.
I went to Comedia to see a particular comedian, and all the way through, I won't name him because it's rude, all the way through, he was going like this, and it was like, you're just making sure you get that last train back to London, aren't you? Mm. I thought that was so awful.
Oh, and my goodness.
I've been checking his set length.
Because if they go over, even by minutes, apparently they start having to pay thousands of pounds. But if he's doing it the whole show, that's
He was
not...
doing it all the way through. You know. And I wasn't impressed.
Ooh,
I
tell
wasn't
us after. Impressed.
I will tell you
after. It's so nosy.
I really want to know.
You know
so
who it nosy. Is, do you?
No, I'm just making that up.
The font of all knowledge.
I mean, it is horrible, that whole thing of filling the time all going over. I mean, do you ever get to, like, the hour length and think, oh, we could do another 15 minutes here? Or is it very tightly scripted?
It's quite structured, so when it's over, it's over.
Yeah.
We could add more sketches.
We've got a lot of material.
We have a lot, yeah.
Well, let's have another sketch. We've got some more on VT. Zahira. Zahura. Play that for me.
Now, through this evening and tonight, thunderstorms are really going to spring to life across northern England and Scotland. Some torrential downpours, maybe some localised flooding issues here. And by the end of the night, also some thundery downpours approaching the far south. These are the minimum temperatures overnight, perhaps not quite as oppressive as last night, but still no lower than around 21 degrees there in Norwich. Now, for tomorrow, two thunder systems will be affected.
If you could change anything about yourself, where would you start?
Look at a little blonder in that.
Do I?
Yes.
That's very funny.
I must have been rinsing my hair with something. It's lighting.
I'm often fascinated when I'm talking to comedians on the show who do tour their shows about the response they get in different parts of the country. Does it go down well everywhere? Or are there places that you've played this and people just sit there looking baffled?
I think it just changes audience to audience.
Yeah, it does. I mean,
we did Edinburgh and
it went well.
It went well some days. It bombed other days and.
getting the right people, because everyone, it's subjective comedy, I think. Yeah. People have different things they find funny. So, yeah, there was one, we didn't market it really well. We got the wrong crowd in, which really, we felt that. But you need to have those moments.
And we had a false ending in that show.
Oh, God, it was awful.
They just left. They were just like, oh, thank God. We were like, we're so not done. And you could just see how they just sat
soul destroyed. Oh, no. And it was just like, Sauvignon Blanc? Yep, absolutely, let's go.
What see, Nikki wouldn't do that. She'd just look like, yeah. Sit down. You don't come in there. I think we've got another sketch we can look at. Let's take a look at that one, so here.
Oh, gosh.
Oh, my God. You have got to drink this.
Why? What is it?
I don't know. I found it on the tube. I just want to see if you'd drink it.
That is wicked. You do see those bottles of things, don't you, hanging around,
gosh.
And you think, they always look to me like they're yellow.
It's Lucozade, isn't it?
And I think anything that looks like Lucozade in a bottle that has been abandoned is probably not Lucozade, is it?
Isn't it?
I found a drink. I found this drink for you. On the tube. It's all yellow.
They'll be doing that.
Oh, yeah.
They'll be lifting that one. Oh, dear. I love those two characters. They're fantastic.
They are.
That look on your face at the end, that sort of, what's he doing to me? It's great.
It's very similar. We've got a lot of other sketches like that, Christmas-based sketches, parents, etc.
I think our sketches have gotten longer.
A little longer, yeah.
We used to very sort of, we did a show, an hour show of just like one. 30 seconds.
We've got substance now, darling. Yeah.
Substance. Well, we've got to go to a break now. When we come back, we're going to be talking and listening to Nikki Mitchell. We'll see you after these ads.
Look out. Look out. We're here for you.
Hello, welcome back to Look Out with me, Andrew Kay. We've been talking to Dave Pop, Sean Hutchinson, Barry Glennon, and now we're going to talk to Nikki Mitchell. Nikki, I mean, I've known you such a long time as a performer and as a friend, which has been lovely. I have some memorable moments with you. You turned up once with a gift for me that was a puppet nun, which I think
Did
your mother had made.
Oh, my God, the puppet years.
The puppet years, yes. your family have a sort of seaside tradition, don't they? They are seaside people.
No, not at all. They were in Warrington and I moved to Brighton.
Warrington?
And they thought, oh, this is good down here. Look, it's grim up north. So let's follow Nikki to Warrington. And my mum left my dad in a huge flouncing, I'm leaving you, and came to Warrington. And then my dad followed with my little brother, and then they moved to Brighton.
And ended up on
a little ice cream shop.
That's what I knew about her.
So we had an ice cream shop, which was hilarious. That was very funny. And then we ended up with another lockup, and that became a puppet shop.
It was a puppet shop.
And my mum started making more and more hideous puppets.
Well, they were really weird. They were all weird, these puppets. But the weirdest one was the nun, and you brought one for me as a present.
I don't know
and
why.
Sadly, I haven't got it any longer.
I'm glad to do it for you.
Along the way. But that, and nuns in things always make
it?
Me smile. I did play with it, yes.
So did you bury it?
Oh, bury it?
Freud.
No, in some sort of strange black matching ritual. No, I didn't. I didn't bury it. I don't know what happened to it, to be honest.
I was busking once, years ago, a man from Birmingham in a mobility scooter came up to me and he said, I'll not give you money, but I will give you this. And he gave me this figurine that had been repaired, so it's, you know, there's all glue marks all over it, of a little, like, vagabond with a little little knapsack over his shoulder.
Have you still got that?
No,
You buried it?
I buried it because it freaked me out, the whole thing, so much. And I was like, he's given it to me with so much intention, and it's been repaired, and I had no idea what to do with it, and it felt like some weird juju, and so I buried it.
Do you think
he
carried it round on the off chance it might
meet
someone?
What is going on in his world? Yeah. I didn't.
It's very
bizarre.
It's like,
okay, I don't want money. If you just have a nice song, it doesn't matter.
Is burying things what you do with it?
No, it's just that thing. I just, do you know what? And I'm still thinking about where it's buried now, even now talking about
it. I think it's creepier to bury it, because if it comes back covered in dirt, you know it's like, you know.
It's possessed.
It's moved, yeah. Whereas if you just put it in a drawer and it came back, you wouldn't know.
The weird world of Nicki Mitchell. But there is a less weird world. And there that is your musical career, yes, which has been very varied over the years. I mean, I've seen you busking on the streets. I've seen you playing cabaret bars. I've seen you on stage at Pride. I mean, I've seen you almost everywhere. On this stage many times, yes. And I've seen you on my own sofa many times. But you've got a new show, and it's a tribute.
I've written a show, it's a work in progress, actually, about Ella Fitzgerald.
Right.
Because we all love Ella Fitzgerald music, but nobody knows anything about her. And I started to read a little bit about her, and I couldn't believe her story. It was incredible. And all of a sudden, I mean, she's peerless as a musician, so I don't even touch the hem of her talent, not even close. But I do my best. But I've written the story of her life and peppered it with songs. So it's a narrative.
Uh-huh.
It's a narrative with some of the songs.
And how many songs are you going to do in this show? Because there is such a catalogue, isn't
there? So many. Probably about 10 or 11.
It's the first slab.
Oh, that's not as many as I've had to pare that down.
Are you choosing your favourites, or are you choosing some less well-known ones that, you know...
A mixture. So there's things that I wouldn't normally attempt that I'm putting in because I really love how they work in the narrative. So there's one that I never do, which is, I'll remember the title of it in a moment. Never treats me sweet and gentle. I got it bad and that ain't good, because I never do it. And it really works, you know. But there's a great quote, and it's full of little quotes that I found. There's a great quote. She got an audition on stage at the Apollo. This is the 1930s in New York. She's living on the streets. Really interesting childhood trajectory. Her mother had died. She's ended up living on the streets, running numbers for a bookie, living in a brothel. And all the girls in the brothel, this to get the audition was a lottery. And people would put their names into her. And all the girls in the brothel said, come on, Ellie, you know, let's do it. And she said, sure, you know, if you'll do it, I'll do it. And they all put her name in.
That's lovely.
Because they knew that she was going to get out, because she kept saying it. I'm going to make something of myself. I'm going to get out. I'm going to make something of myself. And she said it all of the time. And that was a thing that she said all the way through her life. It doesn't matter where you're from, it matters where you're going. And that, and I have so much respect for this woman.
What was her big break?
Her big break was that. Was the
that was one that audition.
Yeah, she went on to dance. She was a dancer. She was
really?
On street corners dancing for money. Yeah, sure. And she went on, and they were these two sisters that always closed the show at the Apollo in Harlem with dancing. And she was like, I can't follow that.
Well, I'm now
and they
to
started
ask
booing. They started booing.
Are you going to dance?
Am I going to dance? No, I'm not going to dance.
But you're going to play. No. Listen, why don't you play something for us now?
Well, okay. Sorry, I went on a bit too long about Ella Fitzgerald.
No, you didn't.
Anyway, my show is at Bombaines on Friday, the 6th of December.
Oh, we've got plenty of time.
And there are 4 tickets left. I always sing this. You can join in if you like.
All right.
All right, Barry.
What, darling?
You can sing it in any accent you like.
Oh,
in Australian.
Don't tempt me.
Stash on and broad above you. Night breezes seem to whisper, I love you. Birds singing in the sycamore tree. Dream a little dream of me. Say night and night and kiss me. Just hold me tight and tell me you miss me. Oh, while I'm alone, blue as can.
can be. Dream a little dream of me. Honey, it's raining, but I linger on, dear. Still cradling your kiss. I'm longing to linger till dawn, dear. Just saying this. Sweet dreams till sunbeams find you, oh sweet dreams that leave all worries far behind you. But in your dreams, whatever they be, dream a little dream of, just a little dream of, dream a little dream of me.
Do you want to do some accents?
Yeah, what are the lyrics?
A different song then?
We could do our, we could do...
Oh gosh.
We do, It's Beginning to Look Like Christmas, the first bit.
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas everywhere you go.
Take a look at the neighbor's den.
It's glistening once again.
With whips and chains and eager eyes aglow.
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas.
Toys where you turn.
But the prettiest sight you'll see
can be seen when on your knees
over at Bob and Fern's.
And it's your turn.
Would you like to sing, Dave?
I'll just draw something.
Peaches.
Oh, absolutely lovely. Absolutely lovely. And that song is in your show?
It is.
That song is in your show? Yep. With at least another 10. The story is fabulous. I didn't know that much about her. I didn't know... I mean, it's a sort of... PF style story, isn't it?
Marilyn Monroe. Very
she said when they said to her, when Ella finished singing, you could have heard a rat piss on cotton.
Nice.
In the Apollo Theatre in Harlem. The place was it was the Glasgow Empire.
Brilliant. You know. Well, it's been lovely having you all here today. I've had such fun. Can we have comedians and singers and performers every week? And artists. It's much.
Forget about the art.
Less of the serious stuff. Less of the serious stuff on Lookout. Nikki Mitchell, thank you so much. Barry, thank you. Sean, thank you.
You're welcome.
Dave, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Dave's paintings can be seen in the foyer of the Theatre Royal throughout the Christmas period. Your show is at the Purple Playhouse for the rest of this week.
Yep.
And Nikki, you're at Bombaines.
I am.
Only 4 tickets left?
Only 4 tickets left. I run a tight ship.
You certainly do, don't you? Thank you all for coming in today. It's been really good fun. Thank you for watching. I'll be back next week. And I have a very special guest coming next week, all the way from Lapland, Father Christmas. Until then, have a nice week. Good night. Welcome back. I'm here at the Theatre Royal Brighton, and I've joined up with Joe McFadden for the second time this year for a chat.
Yes.
And we're chatting about the fact that you're coming to Brighton in Priscilla, Queen of the Desert.
Yes, absolutely.
And we've been talking about the fact that you sing, and you're going to have to sing quite a lot in this.
Yeah.
Of course, Australian drag is all about lip sync.
Yeah, I don't think we're lip-syncing too much, actually, because, you know, at the end of the day, it is a musical. People do expect us to sing.
Of course, I'd be really cross if you didn't
sing.
Yeah,
I think some productions, they do lip-sync more, but I don't think we will be. I mean, who knows?
I mean, it's a massive cast, and, of course, you have the chorus of three backing singers.
The divas.
Who are superb,
yeah.
And that's great fun.
Yeah.
It's quite a heartfelt story. It's actually quite a moving story.
Yeah.
And I think you have to dig underneath the sequins and the lurex to find that. I felt when I saw the stage show originally that the campness of it had been out of kilter with the story
with the heart of the story.
The film.
Oh, that's interesting.
But recently I've seen it again and I think there's a balance has been found.
Yeah, absolutely. And I was speaking to my friend, my newly found friend, Jason Donovan, about this exact thing. And he said that they're going back to the original, they're going back to the film where, you know, it's not about it all being very polished. You know, there's a grittiness to it.
Oh, it's terribly gritty.
Yeah, and a reality. And he's friends with the writer in Australia, and they're very much up for taking it back to the bare bones and not making it this extravaganza. I mean, obviously, in the big kind of show routines, that's going to be spectacular.
Yeah.
But, you know, there should be a reality to it and a real story there. So hopefully,
and are we seeing it's a totally new production?
Absolutely.
So,
yeah.
New costumes, new
design,
set.
Yeah, new
That's
arrangements.
Fantastic.
We've got Kylie songs instead of Madonna songs, I hear.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Oh, I don't know if I should have said that, but we are.
Well, it seems appropriate.
Yeah, absolutely.
Kylie, of course, is coming to Brighton this summer for Pride.
Oh, is she? Oh,
she's the headliner at Pride on the Saturday night, which is superb.
That's amazing. Well, yeah. What a signing.
Well, I mean, we can pull the crowds down here because Pride in Brighton is the best Pride in the UK.
It's a big event. I was there a few years ago, actually,
yeah?
And it rained constantly. The one time I went to Pride in Brighton, and it was like a quagmire. It was like a mud bath.
It was a mud bath. That was the year that the lesbian mud wrestling started.
Oh, was it? I think I missed that.
I moved away.
Yeah, me and my friend Tony Maudsley, who lives here, he went off to the pub instead, where it was nice and dry.
Now, Tony, of course, was here last week in Benidorm.
With Benidorm, yeah, which is fantastic. Yeah.
And it was a terrific show. Really good
brilliant.
Fun.
I saw it up in Milton Keynes.
Yeah.
It's great, yeah.
Really
it was
good,
a good
fun. This House on Cold Hill takes you
through
a little way.
Middle of June.
And then?
6 weeks off, getting used to walking around in heels, trying to get an Australian accent.
Yes, how do you do that with a strong Scottish accent?
You know, I've done accents before. You have a voice coach. We were so used to hear. We grew up watching Neighbours and Home and Away. You know, it's in there. It's a bit like when I had to do American. We've listened to American accents our whole lives. So
yeah.
It felt easy, not easy, but it felt nice to do. Obviously, it takes some refining, but fingers crossed it'll be all right. I'm sure it will.
Now, one of the best lines in the film and in the show is, "I've always wanted to be a cock in a frock on a rock."
Yeah.
You, of course, are going to be a jock in a frock on a rock.
Yes.
Is that going to be on the posters, do you think?
That's quite good, actually. Yeah, I'll get on to marketing. My favourite line is, "There's two things I hate about you, Felicia. Your face." There's so many great lines.
You know this play, don't you? You know it already.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, the thing is, it stays with you. And that's the thing about a show like that. You know, people have such fond memories of the movie that they expect you to sort of, I don't know, to give them a flavour of the movie, but then still put your own stamp on it.
But as you said earlier, when people are familiar with a book that's been converted from page to stage, there is an expectation and there must be a pressure on you to know that you can deliver that.
Yeah.
And with this, I mean, there's a lot of pressure because this film has become iconic.
Absolutely, yeah. You know, it won an Oscar. It was the best movie that year. So it's a pressure, but it's a nice pressure because, you know, people have a real fondness for it. And I think there's a trap that you can fall into where you think, oh, I want to put my stamp on it and take it really far away from the movie. And I think you're doing yourself a disservice in doing that because people expect to hear the lines
of course.
That way. It's a bit like Benidorm, you know, they expect you to be the same as you were on the TV. So you have to pay homage to what has gone before while still putting your slant on it. Yeah, you know, it's fine. It's a minefield, but it's a fun minefield.
In Brighton, of course, at the Theatre Royal here, we don't have a traditional pantomime anymore. We have a Christmas show.
Yes.
Which, I mean, I think I was partly the death of the pantomime theatre.
Really?
Because because the year it died, I gave it the worst review I've ever given anything.
Well, there you go.
With minus 15 stars.
Oh my goodness, the power of a pen.
I'm not going to say who was in it. Jeez. But ever since, I think the Theatre Royal has picked up on the idea that actually at Christmas, with an audience that is as sophisticated as a Brighton's audience, you can do something else.
Absolutely, yeah, definitely. And, you know, there's plenty of pantomimes around. You know, go to Worthing if you want to see a pantomime. But,
absolutely,
you know, there's an audience for both. Take the kids to Worthing and then pop in here on your own. Have a night off and get the babysitter
in. Send the kids to Worthing.
Yeah, send them off. Yeah, send them on a school trip.
Not exactly the right message we're trying to give when we're talking about a production
which
I think is about parenting. And I think that is the really important part of this play.
Yeah.
I mean, when it came out originally, of course, it wasn't that common to find gay parents.
Absolutely, yeah.
These days, and particularly in Brighton, I mean, I think nearly all of my gay friends have kids these
days. Yeah, and that's why it's timely. Yeah, I've got gay friends who've got kids, and that's why it's so timely. You know, it's a story that still needs to be told. You know, it's great in many, many ways.
I think there's an enormous backlash there. I mean, I think if you look online, look at the media and what people are saying, there are people saying that it's absolutely wrong that you know, two women should bring up a child or two men should bring
that's
up a child,
that's why.
Which is absolutely crazy totally because it's nonsense. Actually just about caring and
yeah,
love.
Yeah, if you have a loving environment for a child and you support them and love them, then why the hell not? Yeah. And that, like you say, that is the message of the show.
Definitely. Yeah. Any more television in the line?
Oh God, no, I'm doing this for the next year. So no, this is keeping me more than busy for the foreseeable future.
When does Priscilla actually go out on the road?
September, we open in Dartford, and right. Then it's going to be at a theatre near you. A few theatres in this area.
And we get you for the best bits, though, for the Christmas season.
Christmas in Brighton, how fantastic.
It's going to be really good fun.
It's going to be amazing.
So, and of course, you've been down here a few times, so you'll know your way around by then.
Yeah, I do now, and I love Brighton. It's such an amazing place. You know, it's so arty and cool and laid back and... Yeah, it's sort of one of the other places, apart from London, that I could actually see myself living at one point. Tony's always kind of saying that I should move.
So where do you actually live now?
I live in North London, but when I'm at home, which isn't very often.
Not often, no. No,
no, it's very handy for the M1 to get up to Scotland.
When you come down here, do you think you'll stay for the whole period? Or
Yeah, definitely. Why would you want to leave? Why would you want to get on that train back to London when you're in Brighton?
You can stay here and go out and have fun.
Well, hopefully we'll have some energy for doing that.
Listen, it's been really great talking to
great
you.
To chat to
I
you.
Can't wait to see you do it because it is a favourite show of mine.
Oh, good.
I think it's going to be really good fun.
Nice
and
one.
Hopefully by the time we put this out, we'll have a little bit of footage that we could add in.
Yeah.
That would be nice, wouldn't it?
Yes, absolutely.
I'm sure all of you want to see Joe. In drag. And singing.
As Liza.
And dancing again. Thanks ever
nice
so much,
to see
Joe.
You.
Really nice to see
Cheers.
You again.
Cheers.